Welcome again, friends. In this video tutorial, we'll be talking about the life cycle of HSV, or which is called herpes simplex virus. So let me talk about the herpes simplex virus, and majorly we'll be talking about the life cycle of this herpes simplex virus. Okay, so let's begin with it. Now, herpes simplex virus is having a double-stranded DNA as its genetic material. If I draw the structure, not exact structure, because I won't encourage you to memorize exact protein names of viruses because they are very much complicated, but in a sense I can draw it in such a way. Let's say this is the virus that I am going to draw. Let's say this is the capsid protein of our virus, and surrounding this capsid protein there will be envelope. We all know that this is the envelope. Now, the envelope of this virus will contain certain amount of spike proteins that are required for the host cell attachment. So, these are those spike proteins that are coming out. These are glycosylated molecules that are formed outside. And in between this capsid protein and this envelope, and also in between this capsid and the genetic material, forgot to draw the genetic material. So, the genetic material here is double-stranded DNA. So let me build it. So this is double-stranded DNA as the genetic material, and there are certain molecules inside those molecules. Let me change it. Those molecules, this blue color molecule, these are called the tegument protein, which actually hold these capsid proteins together. It holds the capsid proteins together with the envelope protein regions like that. Okay. These are the tegument proteins. I shouldn't have drawn the tegument inside, because the tegument actually present between the capsid and the envelope proteins. Okay, so it should be the outside, not the inside ones. Okay, so if I mark them properly, what will be the names in this case? This is the envelope. You all know envelope. This is the capsid, and these are tegument protein, and there is an important role of tegument protein during the life cycle of HSV. We are going to see that. And this is the DNA that we all know. It's a double-stranded DNA, dsDNA. So in a sense, HSV is a double-stranded enveloped virus. Okay, so let's begin now. Now, once this virus reaches the target cell, there are receptor interaction between this virus protein molecules in the coat with the host cell receptor. So let me draw it. So if I draw the host cell here, this is the host cell. Inside this host cell there are receptor molecules coming out like that, and these virions can attach with these host cells via the outer receptor. So these are, say, the virus molecules, virus particles, not molecules. Now these virus particles are projecting those interacting molecules here. So due to this interaction, these virus molecules will be internalized. Okay, and during this interaction, this virus molecule kind of fuses with this host cell membrane. So as they are fusing with the host membrane, remind you, in all of this material there are capsid and genetic material, so I haven't drawn it yet. So let's say these are, okay, now once they are fused, so after the fusion, so if I draw the fusion properly, it will look something like that. It will look like this. And due to this fusion, there will be release of, so let me just erase this part. Yeah, and there will be release of this virion capsid into the cytoplasm. That's the important point. And remind you, in all of this case, there are blue color, remember, the tegument proteins present between this envelope and capsid region, this free space. So tegument proteins also start to release onto the cytoplasm. So now in the cytoplasm, what we are having the tegument protein, and also we are having the virus capsid, right? So capsid with tegument proteins are released inside the cytoplasm. Now once they are released inside the cytoplasm, then this capsid will be migrated from the cytoplasm towards the nucleus, and that's a very, 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 very important stage. So let me draw the nucleus here. So let's say in this case, draw the nucleus here. Let me draw it here. So it fuses and then it migrates towards the nucleus, and this is the nuclear membrane, for example. These are the nuclear membrane, and this is the nuclear pore, for example. Let's say this is the nuclear membrane and pore. So they are engulfed inside. So here, this is the nucleus of the cell. So let me write N for nucleus. Now this capsid will migrate. The capsid will migrate through it will migrate through microtubule system, remember, microtubules, and they will reach the nucleus through the nuclear pore. They will deliver their capsid materials, which is the double-stranded DNA, inside the nucleus, and that's a very, very important stage. But before that, once we know, two important things are released here. One is tegumen protein, another one is capsid. Now this, from this tegumen proteins, there are many different varieties of protein present. But majorly two important proteins are there which are having an important function in the life cycle. One of this protein is, so let me write, one of this kind of protein is VHS, or it is called virion host shutoff. Virion host shutoff. And also another protein which is termed as VP16. These two proteins play a vital role in this HSV life cycle. Now this virion host shutoff protein, as we know the name suggesting us all, it will shut off the transcription machinery of host cell. That means, and also it will block the translation of host mRNAs. That's the important part, right? It will go and degrade the host mRNAs which are present in the cytoplasm. So if I draw these are, let's say these are the host mRNA, host cell mRNA. Now this VHS molecules will go and they will degrade this host mRNAs. That's the job of VHS. On the other hand, this VP16 molecules are playing another role. This VP16, if I draw VP16 here in this color, this VP16, which are also present there in tegument. Now this VP16 will pass through this nuclear pore inside the nucleus, and it will help the viral replication and viral transcription, not actually replication, but viral transcription at the very basic level. It helps in transcribing some early genes required for the development of progeny viruses and required for the replication of the virus, right? So it will move inside. So VP16 now is inside. And along with that, we remember, we know that there are the host cell genome is present there. This is the host cell genome inside the nucleus. And also, we know that this viral DNA is also getting inserted inside this. So this is the viral DNA, for example. Now, using this viral DNA, and this VP16 will deliver or will generate some immediate early genes. So they will induce some immediate early genes. Now these immediate early gene products are required for the lytic cycle, and also they are required for the replication of this viral genome, right? So some of this immediate early gene will be immediate early mRNAs which are prepared in nucleus will be migrated outside into the cytoplasm, and once they are inside the cytoplasm, those immediate early genes will be converted into immediate early proteins. Now some of these immediate early proteins will be then taken inside the nucleus again, and those immediate early proteins will help to duplicate the DNA. Now viral part will duplicate its DNA, so DNA duplication, that is the replication, will be done there, right? After the replication is done, there are several varieties of transcription will go on, and early genes will start to produce. So early genes and the late genes start to produce. Now some of those late genes coming from this viral DNA are required for synthesizing the capsid materials. Remember, those tegumen proteins and capsid proteins and membrane proteins, and they will produce those kind of late proteins. And this is the stage they need to determine where they are going to either create the lytic infection or the lysogenic infection, because this HSV or herpes simplex virus can cause both of them. Now the first case, when they produce this immediate early genes, if these genes are, if this virus determines to stay here for long period of time, or if it determines to cause a lysogenic phase or latent phase of the infection, they start to increase or synthesize some other gene products, and those genes are termed as lat genes. Those are termed as lat genes or latent genes. So latent gene expression will be done. If latent gene expression is mediated, then they will be in the lysogenic phase. But if this is not latent gene expression, if it is only the immediate early genes and early gene expression, then they are going to transfer through the lytic phase of their cycle. So that is a determinant between the lytic phase and the latent phase of this HSV virus. So once they reach this particular point, here we are only looking at the lytic phase of the cycle. So they produce the immediate early genes, then again internalize inside, then they produce early genes. Early genes are responsible for the DNA replication. Then they produce the late genes, which are responsible for the production of structural protein. So finally, late gene expression will be there. So let me write the expression here. Late mRNAs. Now they will be taken. Late mRNAs will be converted into late proteins or structural proteins. So these are structural proteins, remind you. Now once everything is made here, structural proteins and the DNAs, which is required as the genetic material, is produced, then what they will do, they will produce a virion inside this nucleus. So the assembly of all structural proteins handling with this double-stranded DNA as the genetic material in the middle occurs inside the nucleus. Once everything is done inside the nucleus, then they bulge out from the nucleus, taking a section of the nuclear membrane with it. Then what will they do? So let me see here. And this is the process. Let me zoom into it a little bit. So inside the nucleus we are there, and now inside the nucleus we made our viruses. We actually made our capsid, and inside the capsid we are having our important genetic material. Everything is produced. Now once it is produced, they will bulge out from this nucleus, taking a nuclear. So they will bulge out. So let me draw like that, and then finally they come out with a nuclear membrane surrounding it. Okay, and inside there is the capsid protein. Now once it is coming out like that from the nucleus, so remind you, this is the nucleus. Okay, it is bulging out. Then what it will do, it will move towards the endoplasmic reticulum, because during this process, inside the endoplasmic reticulum, there are certain type of receptors and protein molecules are produced, and those protein molecules that are produced in ER, because we know that the whole system organizes in such a way that if this is the nucleus, so let me draw it another way. So if this is the nucleus, endoplasmic reticulum should be here presented like this. These are the ER, and then we are having the Golgi apparatus. Remind you, the Golgi apparatus will be there, right? So Golgi apparatus, and then finally the cell membrane, and this is the actual organization, right? So from the nucleus, so let me write the names. Nucleus, this is endoplasmic reticulum, this is the Golgi apparatus, and this is the membrane, right? So once they are bulged out, so where we are at this particular point, with our virus particle inside this vesicle, we are having our virus, right? We are having our virus capsid, right? So now it will move, and we know this, inside this ER there are proteins made. So proteins are synthesized in different regions of this ER like this. So once these proteins are synthesized, this this particular vesicle will fuse with this ER, and after the fusion with this ER, it will migrate inside, and then when it is coming out of the ER, it is taking some of this protein components, some of this receptor components or spike like protein components with it. So now what, how they look like? They will look something like this. This is a membrane, and outside they are having some certain kind of spike like things, and then inside they are having their capsid, and obviously they are having all those tegument proteins inside, right? This is another truth. So that's the virus will look like now. So then after coming out from ER, they will fuse with Golgi apparatus, and inside the Golgi apparatus, those protein molecules that are newly added in the envelope of this virus will be glycosylated, will be modified. After the modification is done properly and everything is fine, it is ready to go, and through the Golgi it will leave by taking a portion of this membrane with it, and then finally what we get our desired virus fudge particle. Not actually our desired, because we never desired to get a virus particle. It is desired by those viruses. So this is the particle, and there will be many more tegument proteins inside like that, and this is the mature and complete herpes simplex virus. Okay, so herpes simplex there are two different types of herpes simplex virus actually, HSV type 1, HSV type 2. HSV type 1 causes common type of cold and those kind of infections. On the other hand, HSV type 2 usually causes a genital herpes. Now among this HSV type 1, this is a latent infection, and obviously this is a lytic infection, and we have seen how lytic infection is properly done. And for the latent infection, I remind you that I've told you always that they produce this expression of LAT genes, and then they will be dormant for several period of time. But when the condition will be on their favor, for example, when the condition is turned around, like the temperature changes or UV radiation or stress response is there, and these particles will bust the cell out, and they will come out from the host cell after the latent period or latency period. So this is the overall process of HSV infection and HSV life cycle, and I hope that's helpful. Thank you.